tomorrow all the things were gone I'd worked for all my life, and I had to start again with just Stan and I thank my God above for living here today, where the flag still stands for freedom and they can't take that away. Stand and say that I'm proud to be an American. Sing it with me. At least I know I'm free. Yet the men who died, who gave that right to me, and I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today. I love this land. God bless. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I forget the men who died, who gave that right to me, and I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today.
This morning is desires that control us. Desires that control us. The chapter begins with two rhetorical questions, both of them in verse 1. First, it asks the question, James does, of his readers, what causes fights and quarrels among you? And secondly, don't they come from the desires that battle within you? Don't these desires which are seem to control us and they conflict with our nature in Christ, they are corrupt and they come from within. And I think this is one of the themes James is accurately stating and letting us know that, you know, a lot of times we try to blame the devil for stuff or blame somebody else. And yet James accurately describes strife among Christians with the terms fights and quarrels. Often the battles that happen among Christians are bitter and they are severe. And we know this because if you've been in a church life very long at all, or in different churches, you may have experienced some of that. Barclay states that James does not mean that they war within a man, although that is also true, but that they set men warring against each other. And you know, if there's anything that should never happen in God's family is that we would be at odds with each other. I thank the Lord for the spirit and the ministry that we have here at Grace Chapel. I would never proclaim that it is perfect, but we are a people who love each other and try to work together diligently with each other for the cause of Christ. There have been times in our past, in your past, maybe in this church, maybe in other churches, where people did not see eye to eye. Where one of them says, well, we should put blue carpet in the sanctuary, and another one says we should put red carpet in the sanctuary. Therefore, you see no carpet in this sanctuary, amen? We're not trying to take sides. We just figure, why put carpet if it's going to cause an issue? Oh, well, this up here. I don't know who picked this out. I don't know. It doesn't matter. Blue, red, or whatever. Oh, Dawn picked it out. Okay. If you wanted red carpet, take it up with Dawn. Amen. Yes, we don't care what color the carpet is, but you know, churches have split on less important things than that. I remember when I first was in the military and I first went down to Panama Canal Zone to serve my 3.5 years there. I joined a church or started attending a church. Didn't join it, just attended it. And I went the first Sunday. I was invited by someone and I went, and it seemed fine. And I went the next Sunday and the church split. And I kind of got a complex about that. But then someone told me, no, this has been building up for quite some time. And honestly, I have no idea why the church split. It was the established church in that part of the canal zone. It had been there for many, many years, and it split. And I didn't ask why it split. But I did end up going to church with a missionary there in Panama who started another and was starting a new work. And I was grateful to be involved in something that really focused on Jesus and what his mission was. So I was involved in that, and it startled me that I go into this church that's singing wonderful praises of God. And the preacher was preaching a good message. And then to find out that this church was at odds with one another. That kind of thing, as I've made up the word, Diane says, should not be like that, folks. Amen? Had ought not to be. That's it. Had ought not to be. I hadn't said that in a while. Thank you. So the source of fights and quarrels among Christians is always the same. It is always in a root of carnality in the believer's life. An internal war within the believer regarding the desires of the flesh. It's where the flesh rises up. And even though we as believers have surrendered our lives to Christ and to His will, it seems sometimes that the old nature wants to rise up, doesn't it? I have the privilege of preaching this sermon in James when I know of no strife or opposition or quarreling or fighting within the body of Christ here in this church. Isn't that great? Because if there was, somebody would accuse the preacher of talking about them. Amen? So I'm glad we don't have that problem today. But it does not mean that it cannot arise. And so we need to pay close attention to what James says. He seems to be bothered more by selfish spirit that these people have and the bitterness of quarrels than he is on who might be wrong and who might be right. You see, in the body of Christ, when there's opposition, it really doesn't matter who's right and who's wrong. That's a secondary issue. In fact, the Bible instructs us, and I'll paraphrase this, but he says that when you come to the altar to worship, if your brother, not you, but your brother or sister has aught against you, has a problem with you, then you should hold off on that worship and go and get that relationship straightened out. You see, Jesus is all about relationships, isn't he? Ultimately, our relationship with him. But he wants us to have good relationships because, listen, when there is animosity, conflict, arguments, and quarrels within the body of Christ, it's like a cancer. It's the type of thing that if you don't deal with it right up front, it's going to spread. It's never going to stay stagnant. Well, James looks here and he sees the spirit of selfishness as the root as people are operating in the flesh. You see, being born again doesn't mean that you can't readdress your selfishness. The Bible says old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new when you come in Jesus. But listen, as long as we live in this carton, we're still got to deal with our own selfish desires. He makes it clear that this argumentative manner comes not from God. When he says your desires, they come from your desires that battle within you, not from the Lord. So when we have problems in the church, and I have been in ministry 27, 28 years now, and I've been in churches that certainly had issues. This church in the past has had issues, all right? But when there is an issue, when there is some odds, somebody's at odds with somebody else, we deal with it. We sit down at the table and we say, put your grievance on the table. Put your issue on the table and let's talk about it. When you don't, and I was not pastoring, but I was a member of a church one time that did not put the issue on the table, and it was terrible because you know what started flapping? Tongues. Tongues start flapping. This one's talking to that one. This one's talking to that one. People are getting a division line or taking up sides because they don't have all the information. And before we take our animosity, our quarrels, our grievances, and we start letting it be a hotbed of gossip, we need to come before the Lord and to get with each other and deal with the issues. Amen? If you got a problem, come tell me. If the problem's about me, tell Brother Don. If it's about him, we'll go to Carl. Because Carl just fixes everything around here. Amen? Praise God. Our desires that rage up in us create us problems. Next in verse 2, I want you to look. He speaks of desires that argue with others, contentiousness. Verse 2 says, you desire, but you don't have, so you kill. You covet, but you cannot get what you want, so you quarrel and fight. You do not have because you do not ask God. I want you to remind you that James is talking to the church here. He's talking to believers that come together and worship God and work for God. Well, James may have in his mind the killing of Abel and by Cain in the book of Genesis. The word here, kill in the NIV, and murder in the King James, was more likely meant to express covetousness and envy within the believer, which in God's eyes is no less serious than murder itself. James sought to force his readers to realize the depth of evil in their bitterness and hatred towards each other. He said, he uses the word murder, kill, to shake them up and get their attention of the seriousness of what they're doing. Darius says that the words, you covet but cannot get, should be translated to harass and oppress through envy. The desire to get what others have leads to discontentment and frustration. James says that the cause of all this is the fact that you don't ask God for what you need. Sounds simple. Well, let's just ask God for what we need. I want you to continue to look. The question in the verse leaves us with, why don't we ask God? I mean, if that's the answer, if James says so clearly you don't have because you don't ask God, then why aren't we asking? So when we look at and answer that question in verse 3, he clarifies his statement. He says, your desires conceal your motives. In verse 3, it says, when you ask, you do not receive because you ask with wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasures. The verse points to the futility of life lived for the purpose of fundamentally of having our own pleasures satisfied. Not only is it a life conflict, but it also is fundamentally an unsatisfied life. When you seek your own pleasures, you're never going to be satisfied. And I tell you, in a world today, certainly in this country, of wealth and prosperity, what we see is that most people are seeking after the desires of their own heart, what they want for themselves. The verse points to the futility of that kind of life. Not only is it a conflict, but it leads to dissatisfaction. It helps us to understand the folly of living life after the lust of the world and feeding our animal appetites. You're tempted to fulfill the sinful nature because you think, or at least hope, that it may be satisfied, but it never is. When we seek after pleasure of the world, it's kind of like getting a fix. We get a little bit of it for a time, it satisfies us for the moment, but then it brings us back to the table longing for more. You're tempted to fulfill the sinful desire when we think and hope for something to satisfy us. I believe that the root of all of this is selfishness. It's what we want, not what God wants. We all know that there's power in prayer, right? Do we believe that? Well, God wants to answer our prayers so as to bring Himself the glory that is due Him. Rather than our prayers and our asking God bringing us good pleasure in this world, that's not what the Scripture is talking about. James does not mean that when he says, ask of God. We all know that God should get the glory in our lives. And if we are asking God to give us stuff for our own pleasure, then God gets no glory out of that. What we should be asking for is, God, what is your will for my life? What are your desires? And you know, the Bible says, and we'll talk about that in a minute. I'm trying to get ahead of myself because it's one of my favorite verses. I'm going to share it with you. God says, ask and I'll give you what? Desires of your heart. And we're going to talk about that in more detail in a minute. But he says, Our wrong motives are how we're praying amiss, according to King James, amiss. We're missing the mark in praying because we're praying with our own motives and not with God's motives and God's will. Right motives, praying for God's will to be accomplished, guarantees that our prayers will be answered. And in John 15:7, it says, listen closely, John 15:7, if you remain in me, and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish, and it'll be done for you. So, wow, you know, I've read this verse years ago when I was younger, and I thought, wow, all I got to do is ask. I'm in Jesus, I'm saved, so I'm good there, and all I got to do is ask, and God to give me what I want. Amen? Anybody cool? Let's turn the air up, please. If we just go to the Scripture and say, well, ask whatever you wish, and that's the part we like, and I will do it, I'll give it to you, then we have missed the mark, and we are praying amiss. Because the Word says in John 15:7, if, conditionally, if you remain in me, which we will remain in Christ, okay, that's a give me, if you will, because we are saved, we are born again by the Spirit of God, and it is Jesus who has saved us and Jesus that will complete our salvation. So we're good there. We can trust God for that and rest in that. If we remain in Him, He says, and my words remain in you. What is He talking about here? He is saying that not only must you put your faith in Christ in that respect, but also you must take His word and make it part of you. Make it the fundamental foundation in your life. That you serve Christ and not serve self. At that point, when we meet that criteria, we are in Christ, born again, and we live by His word, according to His word, then we ask whatever we want. How can Jesus say, just ask whatever you want and I'll give it to you? Let me tell you how that happens. Because when you are being led by the Holy Spirit and not the flesh, when we have given ourselves, surrendered our lives unto Christ, completely and daily, then at that point, we want what Jesus wants. And He said, when you take on my will, when you embrace my will and put your will aside, then my word is in you. And then, because I want God's will, not my will, He says, ask anything you want. Why? Because what I will be praying and asking for is accordance with God's will in my life. Consequently, I am praying, literally praying, the will of God to be accomplished in this world. Hallelujah. You know, realize you can do that? You can pray God's will to be accomplished. You can be a part of what God is doing in this world and the lives of people coming to Christ and knowing Him. You can have input. You can sow into those lives as you walk with Christ, being led by the Spirit. And you can ask for their salvation. You can ask for their healing. You can ask for their deliverance. And He says, I'll do it. Whew. Now I got to get real somber here for a moment and say, Why are my prayers not always answered? Well, there are a couple of reasons, and possibly that could be because God says, no, I'm not going to do that, and therefore I must be praying in the flesh if God says, I'm not going to do it. If I prayed in His will, He would automatically say, I'm going to do it. But so sometimes He says, no, I'm not going to do it if I'm praying with the wrong motive. But then sometimes He says, yes, and He does it because I'm praying in accordance with His will, what He wants to accomplish. And you say, Brother Stan, but sometimes I don't get a no and I don't see a yes. What's happening? Sometimes, listen closely, God says, wait. Wait. God says, I'm going to do it, but not right now. It's not the right timing. And so we pray that God will. I pray that God would save everybody, okay? And I know that's God's will, isn't it? So I can pray that legitimately according to Scripture. But as much as God wants to save every man, woman, and child on the face of the earth, He leaves it up to them. And consequently, unfortunately, some say no to God. I want my own life. I want to be in charge of it. And isn't that our human nature, to want to be in charge of our own lives? To want to call the shots? To want to steer the car? Yeah, that's our nature. But you know, God says, I have called you and saved you by Christ's blood. And by doing that, when we put our faith in Christ, we surrender our lives, our will, to Him. The Bible says, I've been bought with a price. I no longer live my life for me, but I live it for Christ and His glory. Finally, I want you to go with me to James expresses the damage from corrupted desires. Look at verse 4. Here he addresses the church and accuses her of spiritual adultery because of her love for the things of the world. Follow with me. Verses 4 through 6. You adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world means enmity against God? Therefore, anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. Or do you think Scripture says without reason that He jealously longs for the Spirit He has caused to dwell in us? But He gives us more grace. That is why Scripture says, God opposes the proud but shows favor to the humble. You see, this startles me to a degree when James is talking to people in the church, believers, and he looks at them and he says, you adulterous people. Why would he say that? What grounds does he have for speaking to them like that? Well, here's what I see in this particular text. James is talking to believers who are wishy-washy, believers who ride the fence of their culture, believers who, like in Thyatira, we were talking about this morning, they were in the church, but they were compromising their Christianity, their faith, their witness, because they would sow into the economy, they would kind of blend in to the business world and act like them, eating food sacrificed to idols and involving themselves in sexual immorality. And James is saying, you may not have gone to the physical extent, but you have gone to the spiritual extent and you've committed adultery before God because you have turned away from Him and you've turned to the other things of the world. And this can certainly happen to us today if we are not careful. We can get consumed with things like Thanksgiving, Black Friday, even Christmas, and turn it into something commercialized and miss the actual message of Christmas. We're here. Christmas is all about celebrating that Christ had come. He came to earth, left glory and came to the earth. You see, Jesus is the reason for that season. And if we make anything else or we elevate anything else above Him during that time, we are committing spiritual adultery. So God spoke in this way in the Old Testament when His people were attracted to some form of idolatry. As James saw it, their covetousness and their friendship with the world was idolatry. Colossians 3:5 says this, put it to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature. Sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires and greed, which is idolatry. You know, it is not beyond a Christian to commit spiritual adultery. It is not beyond the Christian to enter into idolatry. If we are not careful, the world will drag us right down that path, certainly at this time of year. I detest Halloween. Some of you know that. I did not preach anything about Halloween. I did not educate you on it this year. I just didn't feel led to do that. But I'm telling you today that Halloween is a devil's holiday. Why on earth would we celebrate the devil's holiday? It is a festival of death. And yet we dress our children up sometimes and sit them out on the street just for the sake. We compromise just so they can have some candy and be involved. You know, God says we got to be careful. We could cross the line here. We could start compromising with the world to such a degree that we are guilty. We are those adulterous people if we are not careful. We need to recognize that we have been called out of the world for the sake of Christ so that we are different. The Bible says we are a peculiar people. Now, some of you were that way before you met Jesus. Amen. But we now are peculiar people, and we should be different. The Spirit of God wants our love and our commitment for Him exclusively. When He sees us devoting ourselves to material things of the world and our own pleasures, our own satisfaction, He's jealous of our misplaced devotion. You see, our devotion should be to Christ. But when we get focused on the world, that's where our devotion lies. So could we be these people He speaks about, these you adulterous people? We could be. We need to be careful not to be. So what are we to do with the words of James this morning? We must understand that ungodly quarrels control us, and they're from our evil desires that are within us. You say, except for Christ in me, I am evil. You say, oh, well, I know people who are not believers, and they're good guys, they're good gals. Their nature is evil, according to God's word. Oftentimes, we don't have because we don't ask God. And sometimes, we don't have because we ask God for selfish reasons. I, for one, have been guilty of that. I have asked God based on what I want, not considering what God's plan is. And I need to go back, as we read in the first couple of chapters of Revelation, where He's speaking to the churches, and the last thing He says, repent and turn. Repent and turn. And friendship with the world is misplaced devotion that should be for God alone. As we look at the words of James, these are hard words. These are hard words to people who have given their life to Christ. You and I have given our lives to Christ. But the proof is in the pudding, really. The proof is whether we totally surrender our lives and be disciples of Jesus. You know what that means? It means we do the sayings of Jesus. We do the sayings of Paul as inspired by the Holy Spirit. We do the sayings of John as inspired by the Spirit on the island of Patmos. We do and we act and we conform to the ways of Jesus. That's when we are true disciples. It's not enough to join a church, shake a preacher's hand, or be in church regularly, or even come to Sunday school. That's not what salvation is about. Those are the results of salvation. But to know Jesus Christ today is your opportunity to have eternal life in heaven. And turn yourselves and your thoughts and your desires from the world and turn them to a focus on Jesus Christ. You see, someone said it very well, and I'll close with this word. There's still room at the foot of the cross for you. Amen. Would you stand with me?